All right, good afternoon.
Goedemiddag.
So, how many of you were in my presentation yesterday? Wow, okay, good. So we got a good baseline going here. So the good part about this one is we got a little more time. We can go into a little more detail. And the other thing that was nice was thanks to Dr. Svensson this morning, he really challenged us to take theory to reality and how we may do that. And a lot of what I'm going to show you today is how we've taken those theoretical concepts, better understood them, and tried to package them so that a firefighter can be interested in it, watch it, and hopefully be able to put the two together. So it's bridging it. We're going to watch a lot of videos. We got most of the videos working. There's still a couple that don't work, but we're going to do our best to get through it. So bottom line is we got an hour and a half together. I can't go through 12 years worth of research that we've done and 12 years worth of interaction with the fire service. But what we can do is we can hit the highlights. So what I want to do is pretty much go through a list of what I would consider the top 20 things that we've learned and feel are important for the fire service that we've kind of had repeating themes over the last 12 years. So it's not, well, we saw this once and we thought it was interesting, so that's a highlight. In many cases, it's we've burned, say, 200 buildings, and time after time after time, we keep seeing the same things. So if we keep seeing the same things, we're getting a little more confident in that what we're talking about is closer to reality than something that just was a fluke. Context is extremely important, as Stefan pointed out. We all have a different context. When I think of a house fire in the United States, it's probably different than what you think of a house fire here. And by no means am I claiming to be an expert in Dutch firefighting or European firefighting for that matter. I've been blessed and been able to have a lot of exposure to folks like Simcoe and Hans that have began to allow me into their context and help me begin to understand how it matches up. I've got to spend a lot of time in Sweden understanding their context. And our context in the U.S. is different, but ultimately it's the same fire dynamics. Box might be slightly different. Tools to deal with it might be slightly different, but ultimately the physics is the same. So there's going to be a lot that we're going to talk about here that should be applicable. And like you see here, fire doesn't know where it is. So as you look at some of these structures, while the facade may look a little bit different, look deeper than that. Look into what's going on with the fire. You can't go to enough fires to put all the pieces together. I hit on that yesterday. And as we watched that video of the fire in the Netherlands, there's picture yourself arriving on that first arriving piece of fire equipment, that first engine, and all of the choices that are available to you. And what you see, go to the last fire you went to. Try and rewind that tape in your head and think about what you did. In many cases, even if it was 10 minutes ago, it's a total blur because things happened so fast. So many things were going on at the same time. It was a very dynamic situation. Things were changing. So many times you go back and it's like, well, I was supposed to search for victims and I couldn't see anything and I felt some heat and I remember making my way through the house. Did I search all the areas of the house? Did I miss a piece? So if someone could follow you with a helmet camera everywhere you went and document everything you did on every fire ground, I think in many cases, many of us would be humbled by what we actually accomplished versus what we want to go and tell our friends we accomplished at that fire. And it's hard to look at it that way. Experience and knowledge have to coexist. Stefan beat on that big time. It's not that you can read a bunch of books or watch a lot of videos or go to a lot of UL training courses and automatically you're going to be a good firefighter. At the same time, we have a saying that I like to use is I've got many friends that have been in the fire service for 20 years, but I wouldn't consider that they have 20 years experience. In many cases, they have 1 year of experience 20 times because they've been doing the same thing over and over and over again, not understanding how to improve and how to build on your experience. Because if you don't know what you're looking at, everything is kind of magic. And ultimately, this isn't magic. It's fire behavior. It's fire dynamics. It's very explainable. So we need to, the more you know that, the better you can build on it. And of course, we need to know the why, but we can't overlook the basics either. If you arrive at a fire scene and you've got one set of conditions, and then you turn away and come back a minute later, those conditions are going to change. So if you go back to pull a hose line and you come back, you got to realize that it's not going to be the same picture you looked at when you first got there in many cases. So we got to understand how it's dynamic and need to be good at the basics, because if getting that hose line is important, you better be able to get it there. So here's our top 20 list. I'm going to bounce back up here. So no amount of technology is going to replace the need for you to know your profession. In the U.S. especially, we've been trying to do this for 50 years. In the late 1970s, we began to introduce turnout gear, which was now encapsulating us where it hadn't been before. We would wear long coats and boots and have a lot of areas of the body exposed to heat. We moved to turnout gear, and we incorporated SCBA. Those are two of the biggest technological advancements that our fire service and really the worldwide fire service has made. It's because now heat was less of a problem and smoke was less of a problem. Two big issues that we had that dictated where you could go. In many cases, you couldn't go into the building without those two pieces of technology. So when those two pieces of technology came in, all of a sudden we could go places we could never go before. But we started developing new tactics and new strategies that matched our new capability, in some cases without knowing why, but just the how. And in our scenario, a lot of the fire behavior training got kind of pushed down, and the training of how to put on your equipment properly, how to use it properly, how much air do you have, how do you breathe, how do you get it on, how do you get it off, that information made it into the training materials, not necessarily the what are the limitations of this, and how come we couldn't go there before, but now we can, but does that mean we should? A lot of holes left there. Your workplace has changed, you have to evolve. This goes for all of us. You might fight fires in a house that was built in the 1800s, but the furniture from the 1800s is still not in that house. There is new furnishings put in that house. And since most of you were here yesterday, I won't spend a lot of time on this, but fire grounds are evolving all over the world. And do we understand them? In many cases, there's a theory called the drift to failure, where if you have very small changes that take place over a long period of time, it's hard to visualize or hard to see that that drift took place until there's a major incident that highlights the fact that that drift occurred. And then all of a sudden, you look at a 20-year period instead of a whole lot of one-month periods, and you're like, whoa, how did I miss that? It's so obvious. We're seeing this a lot with what's going on in the fire service. And then I'll play this again just because I love this video. This is, I'm not sure about here, but in the United States, if you want to buy this legacy furniture, it's very expensive, so a lot of people don't have it. And in many cases, even though plastics have been introduced since the 1950s, it's taken decades. I mean, think of how long you keep a sofa. That's not something that's really disposable. They're expensive. You don't keep it for 5 years and get a new one. Maybe today you might, based on how we make them and how cheap they've become. But in the past, that wasn't the case. So we're finally getting to the point where you'd be hard-pressed to find one of these, to find a cotton sofa. And you probably wouldn't want to pay a premium for it. It's not as comfortable. It's not as durable. So all of these things, through material advancements, we've improved. And we forgot to drop a candle on it and see what happens. And then it's one of those things that you kind of know by feel, but until you see it side by side, it's kind of shocking. And I know in many cases, over the presentations over the last few days, we've been discussing response times from 5 minutes to 45 minutes. Well, in many cases, there's no way you're getting there and doing something in less than 3 minutes and 40 seconds, but in many cases, you are in 29 and a half minutes. So do you understand the stage of fire development you're arriving to? Makes a big difference. You never want to be between where the fire is and where the fire wants to go without water or a door to close. Pretty much you have two levers that you have control of. You can limit air or you can flow water. That's what you have available to you as a firefighter. Do you know how to best use those two tools to accomplish everything that needs to be accomplished? One issue that we were seeing that we developed over time was, if you look at this layout right here, so you've got a bedroom, a hallway, a living room, and it goes out into a public corridor. So this is an apartment building. And what we were seeing was firefighters felt that if fire is coming out of here, so this window fails, which you'll see shortly, that's this window right here, we lit a fire in the bedroom. If this window fails and fire is coming out of that window, that fire is localized, and because it found a low pressure, it wants to stay there and it can't go anywhere else. So firefighters would see fire coming out, they would arrive and they would let their guard down and say, this one's gonna be easy because it's gonna stay there. And with what today's energy loads and the amount of energy that's created, what we see here is it wants to go to whatever low pressure you give it because it's creating more energy than that box can hold and certainly more energy than this window can let out. We assume that it's got an opening to the outside, so that's going to limit it, and we forgot about the air going in. So when you let that air go in and you can increase the amount of energy that fire is releasing, and it's more than this window can allow out, it's going to split and it's going to go to every low pressure provided, this way included. So the firefighters would be surprised that they're coming this way and all of a sudden the fire's coming over top of them, not understanding what was going on when it's simply high pressure to low pressure. Which leads us to this one. Earth shattering. Shouldn't be anything new to anybody. Simple physics. But the theory, does the theory match reality? And how do we make the theory match reality? Our training manuals would all say, you want to vent, make an opening as close to the fire as possible, because that's where all the bad stuff is, and you want to let the bad stuff out. What the training manual forgot to say was, well, you want to let, if you make it close to where the fire is, it will allow it out. But it also allows the air right where it needs to go to grow the fire. So when you separate ventilation from suppression, venting near the fire becomes a horrible thing to do. But that's not what the training manual said. What it should say is, well, you vent near the fire and put water on the fire quickly, and then once that fire is controlled, then those vents are going to work very well for you, because that low pressure is close to the high pressure being created by the fire. And as well, it says, well, don't vent far from the fire. Well, if you've got a vent here and the fire's here, and you vent back here, and air comes in from both, and that fire grows, it's going to go to whatever low pressure you make for it. So you can systematically burn a building down very easily, and it's very predictable. If you want the fire in the kitchen, How do you get the fire in the kitchen? You open a window, right? Or you open the door to the kitchen, create that low pressure, allow the air in, get the mixing, fire comes out the kitchen. I want fire in the dining room. Well, can you have fire in the dining room if you don't have an open window in the dining room? No, there's no air to burn. So if there's no air to burn, you can have heat. You can have fuel. Is it going to get hot in there? Absolutely. Is this material going to begin to off-gas and pyrolyze and create unburned fuel? Yes. But if that fuel can't burn unless it has air. So it's very understandable if we wanted to burn this house down, what the best way to do it would be. Here's a real-life example. You've got fire in the rear of the house. The homeowner leaves, or the fire department arrives and they open the front door. Where's the fire going to go? It's going to go to the low pressure. Vent, enter, isolate, search. This is a tactic of opportunity that our firefighters will use when they have a known life hazard or plausible life hazard, instead of going through the front door and searching throughout the house. If you think there's someone in that room right there, they will go ahead, they will open that room, throw a ladder, go in, close the door, search the room, and come back out. Now, this goes against what a lot of people feel about taking hose lines with everyone in the structure and things like that. But this is a tactic of target, tactic of opportunity. We're able to do experiments where we look at, well, what's the feasibility of doing such things? Under what conditions does it make sense? And what we found was, well, the most important thing you can do is isolate the room that you enter. Because if you become part of the flow path, you're going to put yourself in a chimney and things are going to go bad really quickly. So here we are with the New York City Fire Department. We had 20 townhouses close to Manhattan that we were able to burn. So there's a fire in the first floor, and we have two bedrooms on the second floor. The first window we opened had a closed door. Hang in there with me. This one had a closed door, and you can see there's no smoke coming out of there. It's isolated from the flow path. So the moment they opened it, things got better. This has an open door. And you can see how the conditions are dramatically different. If you put yourself in this outflow, you start understanding real quickly what convection is. It's going to get hot really fast. As those gases flow past you at about 10 to 15 miles per hour. What's that, meters per second? There you go. Okay. Venting does not always lead to cooling. Well-timed and coordinated ventilation leads to improved conditions. This gets back to, in many cases, how we teach. If you teach ventilation by itself, then you start to learn all the positives of ventilation alone. If you don't put ventilation and suppression together, like Stefan said about day four, so you get to day three and everybody understands the individual subjects, but where do we put them together? And in many cases, we were seeing that we weren't putting them together well, so people started looking at them isolated. Here's a fire in New York City. There's a firefighter right here. His responsibility is the outside vent man. His job is to get in position and make openings opposite the hose crew so that when they start advancing on the fire, that steam and pressure moves ahead of the hose crew and doesn't come back over top of the hose crew. Well, this fire had vented itself, so he didn't have to vent these windows. However, he had the option to vent this window and vent that door, and he waited. It's taken a little while to get to this place. In many cases, he would have thought, well, I got to let the bad stuff out, so I'm going to vent this window and this door regardless of where the water is. And then what would have happened? Well, you would have had fire out of this window, and you would have had fire out of this door and fire out of these windows, right? The fire would get larger. However, he had the patience to wait until water was in place, and then he made his ventilation when he knew his ventilation was going to work. These are small changes that could make a big difference to someone that could be laying in that apartment somewhere. This is what happens when you don't have this patience. So a crew shows up, and they're going to let the bad stuff out. So they're making openings. You can see the hose line is not there yet. So when we don't have the water to put on the fire, what's the air going to do to the fire? It's going to make it larger. So when you don't coordinate things and you feel that you have your responsibility and you're going to do your responsibility independent of everything else that's going on, bad things happen. Now, these firefighters aren't intentionally making this fire larger. They don't have good fire dynamics training. They were probably surprised that the fire got larger. And here you have a good introduction to our construction. We've got plastic on the outside that is readily available to spread the fire. So now not only is there an inside fire problem, there's an outside fire problem. It will be over very soon, and they put the fire out very quickly, because it doesn't take a lot of water in the right place to make the problem go away. No one got hurt. The fire did go out. So the question is, how do you measure success? So if we measure success as no one got hurt and the fire went out, we're missing opportunities. Because ultimately, if the homeowner was watching that, they were probably getting stressed and getting stressed and getting stressed that their entire house was going to burn down. And then they breathed a sigh of relief as the fire went out. But ultimately, was that a success? Firefighters didn't get hurt and the fire went out. Maybe a little more property got damaged, but no, this is a problem. Because this got that way as a result of what the firefighters did after they arrived. None of your public around the world expects that things are going to get worse after you get there. So we should not be shooting for something like this. A little more coordination would have gone a long way. Water in the eaves can get the water where it needs to go for an attic fire. Go ahead and this is the one that's outside the program. This is an experiment that we did in our laboratory. And attic fires can be a big deal for us. We've got a lot of lumber in this area. It could be a lightning strike, it could be an electrical short, for whatever reason the fire is in the attic space. And the common answer to these fires is, well, it burnt through the roof, so there's a big hole in the center of the roof, it's burning out of the side of the roof, and in many cases the answer is, we'll pull everybody out, we're just going to start throwing water in from everywhere until the problem goes away. Or we're going to get underneath this and we're going to pull the entire ceiling from inside down and start spraying water everywhere. Well, what if you understand the geometry and you understand how air moves through an attic space and you understand what's important for where to put your water, you start realizing that if you put water into that eave line, and in our construction, our attics are ventilated, so air comes in here and gets vented out through the top so we don't have moisture build up in the attic space and develop mold. So you can take advantage of that construction feature, and most of the fuel that's available to burn is the surface of that sheathing, and that's also where the air is moving past. So that's your optimal locations to burn, is all of the sheathing. So pretty much what I did right there was almost fully extinguish 1,000 square foot attic fire flowing about 120 to 150 gallons a minute, so 480 to 500 plus liters a minute. But when you put it in the right place, you don't need that much of it. If you go ahead and start flowing through the hole and putting ladder trucks up and everything else, you're going to use in a lot of water. This is what that looks like. So your water goes up, it puts the sheathing out on both sides, and it rains down in the middle, very optimally puts that fire out. Now, is that going to work on every single type of structure? No. But is it a tool and a configuration you can pay attention to that you may come in handy? Absolutely, under the right conditions. Don't let our training props set us up for failure. Stefan hit this, so I'm not going to spend a lot of time. We've killed firefighters in training because we've maybe had a little too bit of realistic conditions that were unanticipated. We didn't expect the fire behavior to be what it was because maybe we're used to fighting fires in a concrete building, and then they put a real fire in a non-concrete building and they expected it to be similar. They expected that model to reflect reality until the model gets close to reality and then something goes bad. So in many cases, we can't do that anymore. So we have concrete buildings, in which case we normally put little stacks of pallets and some straw and we light them on fire. And in many cases, we've made firefighters that are really good at fighting a training prop fire, but it doesn't get matched to reality. So when they get to reality, they're not prepared. They're not trained for what they're being faced with. So this can be a challenge that Stefan hit on so well, is that context, that ability to make sure that your instructors make sure that what the students learn here gets matched to reality, because the prop is not going to do it for you. If you have a fuel-limited fire and you ventilate it, it's going to get better. That's what fire you have here. If you have a ventilation-limited fire and you ventilate it, the fire is going to get worse. Do the students know that? Because if you build a prop that shows them that, then it's going to be very different fire behavior and you could have a lot of issues. Forcing the front door is ventilation and must be thought of as ventilation. We have a lot of teachers, and this video isn't working, so I apologize, but we have many teachers that are really good at teaching how to break open different types of doors, whether it's certain locks, whether it's certain thicknesses, whether it's new technologies, whether it's different tools. They spend hours upon hours upon hours talking about how to force doors open, which is good. It's necessary. However, in many cases, that doesn't get combined with ventilation. And when the door gets forced open and it gets thrown all the way open, oh, I did my forcible entry job. Yes, well, now you have a ventilation job. What's going to happen now that you're allowing all that air in and those hot gases coming out? Are things going to get better or get worse? How are you going to read those conditions? We need to know how to do that. Control the door, limit the size of the fire. Tradition has told us, as crews go through doors, we have a lot of wooden door chocks that we like to carry on our helmets, in our pockets, in our gear. And in order to keep that crew from getting stuck behind the door, having the door close on them, we chock it open. So when you open it all the way up, you're obviously letting the most amount of air in. And that air happens to be coming in behind the attack crew, providing a low pressure behind the crew, so where's the fire going to go? It wants to go through the crew. Well, what if we limited that? This might be another one that's not going to work. So what we did in this experiment was we took one house, opened up the door to let the crew in, and then closed it halfway behind them. So it didn't impede the hose line going in. It was just closed. It limited half. In the other one, it opened completely up. And here you can see the data that when the door is completely open versus halfway closed, that gave an extra 3 minutes before that fire got out of control. That's three more minutes that that crew has to put water on the fire, in which case the temperatures wouldn't do this, they would do this. In a two-story house, where the fire was further away from the door, opening the door right away made the fire increase quickly. Controlling the door didn't allow the fire to grow at all because not a lot of oxygen was making it to the seat of the fire. So a little thing like door control or having a person at that door to limit the air as hose gets moved into the structure can have a really big effect on the fire growth in the rest of the structure. We need to appreciate that. No smoke showing means nothing. Once an opening's made, you have to pay attention to it. In test after test after test, we would see as that fire is growing, as it's increasing in size, it creates a high pressure and it is forcing smoke out around every single opening in the structure. Again, high pressure to low pressure. However, once that fire is not getting the oxygen that it wants to grow, is not able to get as much as it needs, the fire begins to decrease in size. As it decreases in size, it decreases the temperature. And in this case, the temperature actually decreased about 1,000 degrees. So when it decreases that much, those gases that were heating and expanding are now cooling and contracting. As they cool and contract, all of a sudden, you're seeing something very different. So if you arrived at this house fire 1 minute ago, is very different than if you arrive right now. You're going to see very different things. Does that mean the hazard, because no smoke's coming out, the hazard is very down? No. It's actually going to react more to your intervention than the other one would be. So it's important to understand that. The other one is, when you do open the door and you see air going in the bottom of that door at several meters per second, that's a really good sign that that fire is starved for oxygen. So in this case, that's a really good fire where if that hose line is not ready to go, that door gets closed until that hose line's ready to go, so you're not feeding that fire. The other concept that becomes really important is the concept of neutral plane. Where is the neutral pressure plane in the structure? And this is a good one for fire chiefs or crew commanders that have command of a fire ground. That if we have a lot of basements, and you can imagine it's very hazardous being on top of a basement fire, not a place that you want to be. So if this front door gets opened and creates a pressure to the outside of the structure, as you look at that smoke in the front door, you can know where that fire is inside that building based on the neutral pressure plane. So if that fire is on this floor, let's say it's back here, you're going to have smoke coming out of the top two-thirds, air going in the bottom third. If you open that front door and you have smoke coming out of that door top to bottom, and there's no air going in, or very little air going in, that fire is below you. If you go through that front door and the smoke begins to lift to the top of the door, fire's above you. So you want to make sure that as your crews are communicating what their strategy is and where they think the fire is, that the conditions that you see on the outside are matching what they're telling you from the inside. They may think they have a fire on the first floor, so they go onto the first floor, and that smoke is telling you that fire is below them. You need to make sure that your strategies match. Coordination of vertical ventilation must occur with fire attack, just like horizontal. This is another thing that we do a lot in the United States that doesn't get done in many other parts of the world. However, there's still an important point to make here with fire dynamics. And it also gives an example of what some of our experiments look like. So we've got a fire in the living room in the front of this house. And over here, we're going to open up a 1.2 meter by 1.2 meter hole. Over here, it's going to be 1.2 meters by 2.4 meters. What we're trying to show is that fires today produce so much energy that even if you allow it to go straight up, it can't all go straight up. So it increases in size, and it goes up, and it goes out. So you can't, by just the simple practice of making a hole over the fire, allow all the energy out. Maybe in the past you could, with lower energy potential inside structures. Today, it's not as easy to accomplish, so things get worse. So you're going to have fire coming out of the roof, and you're going to have fire coming out of the front door. Over here, you're going to have several square meters of fire coming out of the roof and coming out of the front door. So again, does that mean for our purposes, vertical ventilation is a really bad thing? No, it just means it needs to be timed with suppression, just like everything else. Because if some water goes in through that door, conditions are going to improve very quickly because that low pressure out that roof is going to act very favorably. We'll skip that. Knowing how your turnout gear works is critical. Energy flows from high to low. It's amazing how many firefighters don't understand how their protective equipment works. It protects you by absorbing energy. So energy, as soon as you go into an environment that is hotter than you are, a process is taking place. It's increasing the energy of every layer of your gear, starting with your outer shell, moisture barrier, thermal liner, your clothing, and then your skin. Essentially, it's a delay. It delays the heat making it to you, so you're protected. The problem we're seeing is that many firefighters will go into an environment, and because they're not immediately feeling heat, they continue to move. But then the moment they begin to feel heat, then they start thinking about the heat, and then you realize by that point, you've been energized for quite some time. Things are going to go bad in a hurry. And that's what's happening. A lot of times where we see this is in our training environment, where we have the firefighters that are responsible for lighting the fires are in the environment for a long period of time. So their gear is full of energy. They feel really hot. However, the students come in. They don't have any energy in their gear. They get up to the fire, they put water on the fire, and they feel no heat whatsoever. And that's where the instructor's experience, he feels he's showing the students a lot of heat, when reality is they're not feeling any heat at all because their gear is doing exactly what it's supposed to do. It's limiting the heat. They go back outside. Now they're in an environment where the energy's leaving their gear, and all of a sudden, they're looking at each other like, that's it? This is what firefighting is? I don't feel any heat. But the instructor thinks they felt a lot of heat because the instructor was feeling a lot of heat. Again, it's matching the theory to reality. Keep the wind at your back. This is one that we've had several firefighters die because they've been approaching from this side. So this is the hallway. And what we're going to do here is we've got a 15 mile per hour wind hitting this side of the structure, and this window is going to break. Watch how conditions in the hallway change once the window breaks. So it goes from no problem whatsoever. You can crawl right in there with your hose line and make one turn and put water on the fire, to you can't crawl below that. There is no number of hose lines flowing any amount of water that is going to push against this, because ultimately you wouldn't be putting any water on where a predominant amount of the fuel is going. You can't shoot your hose line, have it make a left-hand turn and go 10 meters and hit the fire. We're not there yet. Not quite. Thermal imagers can help indicate there's a basement fire but can't be used to assess structural integrity. There's some people, again, that don't understand the limitations of their tools. So if you understand a thermal imaging camera, you understand that it's a surface temperature reading device. It tells you what the surface temperature is. It can't see through things. So in many cases, this is from an actual test, you can have 1,300 degrees Fahrenheit, say 600 plus C under the floor, and have a piece of wood, carpet padding, and carpet, and have no temperature increase whatsoever on the top of the floor. Because wood is a very good insulator. It keeps the heat from passing through. So if you're on top of this and you scan it with your camera, you have no indication there's a fire below you. Kind of like this. There it is. You wouldn't know that with the thermal imaging camera. Except for the little crosshair that's in the center of your screen that tells you what the temperature is, which, again, you're correct. What it might be, based on pixel averaging. Yes. So, again, yes. We could do 8 hours on thermal imaging cameras, easy, as to the benefits and limitations and the different technologies. They've come a long way, and they all do very different things. And the other thing is there's not a lot of standardization amongst them. So one might do something different than the other one, but how would you know? Unless you read the 500-page manual that comes with it that may or may not say what it's doing. Fight the fire on the level that it's on. We've had a tradition for a long time that suggests that if you have a fire in the basement, so you have a fire in the floor below you, that you go in through the first floor, you position yourself at the top of the stairs, and you flow water to shield the fire to keep it from coming up the stairs. And I've got a big problem with this. So what are we doing about putting this basement fire out? Absolutely nothing. Now, could we be buying some time for some people to search the rest of the house and potentially get victims out? Possibly. But you're sitting on top of the chimney doing nothing about what's below you. And the cool part about the research is we can make these measurements to prove these points. So you see here that the temperature at the top of the stairs did not drop that much. The impact was very local, so we dropped it 200 degrees F at the top of the stairs. The basement continued to burn 600 C plus in the basement. So let's look at the alternative. What if instead of going on top of the fire, that you put water on the fire? Through this front window here. Revolutionary, I know. The thought was that if we put water in through that basement window, that we will push the fire up the stairs and trap or kill any occupants on the floors above. That was the thought, because you couldn't really experience this, or the way that people have experienced it is you have firefighters that are trying to make it down the stairs, and at the same time you have firefighters flowing water, and in many cases maybe a fog pattern, and some steam comes up the interior stairs, and that doesn't feel good. Or those firefighters get mad that they were going to put the fire out, but these guys put it out instead. So these things happen. Well, let's look at what we did to temperatures. Dropped them much more, and we put the fire in the basement out. We didn't push a fireball up the stairs. It didn't happen. Solar panel systems. Anybody fight solar panel system fires? I think you may do a few more in the future. We did a big study where we looked at the hazards associated here. And what I want to tell you is don't be scared to put water onto a solar panel system that's on fire, but I want you to follow two rules. If you have a broken stream or a fog nozzle, you want to use a broken stream. That way the electricity can't make it back down the stream to the person holding the nozzle. If you have a straight stream or you need to really throw the water far to hit the panels. Make sure you're more than 6 meters away. If you're more than 6 meters away, then that wall, that electricity is not going to make it back down your stream. And that's looking at 1,000 volts DC, which is, in Europe, you can have 1,000 volt DC systems. So you need to understand what that DC power is and what that means to you and why solar panel systems can be a hazard, because there's, you don't know where those wires are running. And you need to understand how those systems work. How are we doing with time? Good? Good? Awesome. I could sit here all day. Water does not push fire. This was and still is a major debate that many people feel that if you put water in through a window, that you are forcing fire into the rest of the structure and essentially giving up on any potential occupants that may be inside, and that you have to fight the fire from the inside, pushing the fire out. We've done a lot of tests looking at this. There's a number of names for it that fly around the internet. This goes back to, again, New York City. So here is fire coming out of, or getting ready to come out of the kitchen window. We lit the fire one room in from that, so the fire is spreading from the middle room out the front room. And what we're going to do is we're going to take a straight stream of water and put it off the ceiling into that room and essentially let it rain down like a sprinkler head, wetting most of what is in that room. And what, look at the behavior at the window there. When you use a straight stream, the fire gases want to move to a low pressure, right? That's why the heat and smoke was coming out of that window to begin with. So when you use a straight stream and that water goes in and it begins to cool and water begins to convert to steam, it also wants to go to a low pressure. If everything else in this structure is closed, where's the only low pressure? At the window, which is why the rest of that window, other than where the water's going in, continues to act as an outlet. So you can't push the fire into the structure because it's already a high pressure. You can't push it against another high pressure. It wants to go to the low pressure, which is outside. Here's what those temperatures look like. See, the kitchen dropped over 1,000 degrees. The middle room where the fire started dropped by half. The back room saw no temperature increase whatsoever. Can fire burn back here? If this room is flashed over and this room has fire coming out the window, there's no air. Can you push this high pressure against that high pressure? It's not where the gases want to go. The gases want to come here to the low pressure. Now, what if these windows are open? We'll talk about that. The door closest to the fire truck should not dictate your line or stream placement. We have many fire departments around the world that no matter what, the hose line's going through the front door. Doesn't matter where the fire is. It doesn't matter what they see. It doesn't matter what's going on. The front door is going to open, and they're going to go through the front door. So let's play a little, let's play a European exercise here. I've never done this one before, so this will be fun. Fire's coming out of the front door. Where does your first hose line go? Through the front door? Anybody going to do anything other than that? That's brave enough to say so? Okay, so everyone's going to go through the front door. Why are you going through the front door? It's where the fire is, right? So you're going to put water on the fire immediately? Are you worried about pushing the fire into these bedrooms back here where people may be laying on the ground? No? Not anymore. That's the U.S. response that I get. All right, now fire is coming out of the back door. Where's the first hose line go? Front door? Kitchen door? Front door and close it. So you're going to come in, you're going to control the door, and then you're going to come back here and spray water? Okay. Can you get water on the fire faster from here or from here? Okay. Let's say this is one on the end of the row. Rich people's houses catch fire too, so you're the rich person. You show up to a rich person's house on fire at the end of the row with no exposure here, no pit bulls, and no giant fences. Where do you put the first hose line? Kitchen door? It's important that we know these things ahead of time and that we know why we do them. In many cases, everyone will say, well, I'm always going through the front door because if I go through the front door, I can get the line between where the people are and protect them. And then some people will say, well, I won't put water here because I'm going to push the fire inside. But if I go to this fire, I'm going through the front door. It's like, wait a second, it's the same thing. We just rotated the house a little bit, and now the physics are going to change? It's not the case. If you understand fire behavior and you understand your crew capability and the expectation of your crews, there's not going to be one right answer. But you need to be doing it for the right reasons, and everyone needs to be on the same procedure before you go to the fire and not try and figure out on the fire itself. What if the fire's coming out of the front window? Put the water through the window? No? Through the front door? I got a brave man here that's willing to nod his head. Okay, so why not through the window? Because you're going to push the fire on the inside? So what stream are you going to use to... So you're going to... What kind of stream are you going to use as you open the front door? Okay. So if you're going to search the premise, where are you going to enter to do your search, and where are you going to do your search? Through the front door. Okay. So what if you have to force that front door open? What are you going to do? Are you just going to let the fire burn while you're working on getting the door open? When it's burning cleanly?
Yeah.
Okay, so you're going to let it burn cleanly while you search back here?
Yeah.
Interesting. Which country are you from?
Estonia.
Estonia, okay. Do we have anybody from the Netherlands that would do that?
Sweden. In Sweden, they teach what he said.
Okay.
Burn and
okay. I would use that practice... Well, a Swedish guy doesn't want to agree now. No. But this is a great example, right? Okay, we got another Swedish guy. He's covering his face. This is phenomenal, and we need to talk about these things, and we need to be... Nobody's laughing at anybody. We got to understand their context. And what I would say is, if I'm going to let this fire burn... and I think I can safely search any of these areas, I don't see a scenario where that's possible. Because I need to get inside somehow, and if I go in here, this is on fire, I'm not going that way, it's impossible. And if I open the back door and try and come in this way, where's the fire going? Right behind you. So if I try and come in through a bedroom window, the only opportunity there is to make sure this door is shut, and then, yes, I can search there, in which case you're getting no benefit from the fire burning cleanly. And if this fire is burning out of the window, is anything burning cleanly in here at all? It's black to the floor because it's a ventilation-limited fire. Now, let's say it doesn't have fire coming out of here, and we have a couple pallets on fire in that front living room. Now I agree with that theory, because if that burns cleanly, then we'll be fine to search back here because that fire's not going anywhere. It'd actually be a nice campfire. It might give you some light and it might make it easier. Go ahead.
We do it with two small diving crews, because our arrival is especially in urban areas.
Uh-huh. Very quickly. Absolutely. So now we're combining suppression with ventilation, right? Suppression with search. So now a lot more is possible. But if I'm this forcible entry crew, or I'm that second crew, and I want to search here, the only prayer I have of searching back here is if water goes on this fire. And now we can argue, well, if I put water through the window, is that the same as putting water through the door? Yes or no? Does the fire know if the water is here or here? No. So I would say whatever's fastest. So if you have two crews arriving simultaneously, in the United States, it is not uncommon for us to be able to put in excess of 50 firefighters on the fire ground in less than 5 minutes. So resources are not a problem in a lot of our urban areas. Fire department I rode with, you'd have 4 engines, 2 ladder trucks, a rescue squad, and 3 or 4 battalion chiefs, probably in about 6 minutes. My problem as a chief was figuring out what everybody was doing because they were all doing it at the same time. However, we had standard operating procedures that heavily dictated what people did to start, where the water was coming from, where the hose lines were going, where the truck crews were going, who was supporting who, and all these things were happening in parallel. So what was a blessing could also be a curse. Because if I have one hose line, the first hose line doesn't get in place, guess what the truck guys are doing? They're going to try and go through the fire to do a search because it's not their job to put water on the fire. It's their job to do the search. But this happens to be the fire where no water went on. And now all of a sudden they're laying in the front yard smoking, trying to figure out what just happened and why this fire was different than they did the same thing a week ago and it wasn't a problem. These are how all these tactics go together and where context is important. And you can't watch one snapshot and have a problem with what people are doing. Last one, flow path and suppression must be considered together. This is what we've been talking about. So if you start looking at how fire grows and spreads and putting your ventilation with your suppression, so we have a fire in the bedroom in the front of the structure. We're going to do an interior attack. So the hose line's going through the front door and we're going to put water on that fire. So if we open that front door and we do nothing, where's the fire going? It's following the flow path. I made it easy, the big blue arrow. That's where it's going. It's going to make its way this way. So that's no good. So the firefighters, in many cases, what would you do in this scenario? What would you do to this area as you made it to here? Cool it, right? So how would you cool it? Fog pattern, gas cooling? The way that Simcoe taught you? The way that Hans taught you in the metal container? Yes? No? They're not sure. They're kind of confused right now, too. So. In the United States, we have low-pressure, high-flow hose lines. So this crew right here would probably have something between 400 and 700 liters a minute. That's what they're using. So when they gas cool, or it's been thought that they don't want to gas cool, they want to make it to the fire before they put water on it, because that way they won't make steam. Because if they make steam here, where's the steam going? Right back over their head. It gets really uncomfortable. So we're going to go ahead and we're going to try and crawl here and hope that we get water on the fire before the fire comes here. Not a good plan. So now we need to make sure that we cool the environment. So if you cool the environment, what's the best way to do it? Well, in your case, high pressure, low flow, you have really small droplets that are really efficient at cooling. But how do you know if you have enough to make sure that the fire doesn't come this way? How many pulses is it? How much water do you have to flow? 5 liters? Is it the same in the steel container as it is in this house on fire? Do we know? How long of a pulse do you use? Half a second? 5 seconds? Do you know when to use one versus the other? These are really important questions and things that if you go to a fire tomorrow and you need to gas cool this area and you have zero visibility and you feel heat, how do you know what to do? Doesn't have to be an answer, just want you thinking. Now we have a vent opposite the fire. So we have two flow paths. Where's the fire going to go? Both ways. Very good. We're learning. We're doing good here. So we're going to make an interior attack. What type of pattern are we going to use before we get to here? Are we going to do the same exact thing? Are we going to gas cool and then get here and then flow water? Maybe, maybe not. Do you know the difference? In the United States, what I would say is, if there's a low pressure here and a low pressure here, and the fire's going to go both ways, it's trying to tell me something. I prefer it goes this way. So I have options here. Am I going to use a straight stream and hold it still? Probably not, because it's not going to create a high pressure here. Might I use a fog stream here? Might I take a straight stream and move it around rapidly? Because if I can create a high pressure here, where's the low pressure? Here. So everything's going to move ahead of me and move out of the structure. Here, if I use longer pulses, is different than if I use longer pulses here. If I use longer pulses and I create more steam, it's coming back over me. Over here, if I use longer pulses and create more steam, I can actually use that to my advantage and move it through the flow path here, helping put the fire out. Now, if I use long pulses, am I going to steam the victim in the back room here? No, why? It's already a high pressure back here. The low pressure's here and here. So you're not going to put a steam bath back here. It wants to go this way. What if we have a flow path now through the victim's room? Now, if we do nothing, everyone dies. That's a horrible story. If we flow a lot of water and produce a lot of steam, is it going to go over top of the victim, potentially causing bigger problems? Sure, it's a low pressure. You can make stuff go there. So here, you probably don't want to flow as much. You want to cool the environment. In our case, we would use a straight stream. So we do some cooling, but we wouldn't create a high pressure. And then once you make the turn, now you want to create a high pressure here because everything is now going to be forced here, improving conditions here and where you are. So again, you might use several different nozzle techniques on the same fire depending on where you are in relation to the fire, where the flow paths are, how much air you're in training with you. Do you know how much air you bring in as you're flowing your fog nozzles? Could be a lot. Could be a significant amount. You can use it to your advantage. It can also work against you. These are things that we don't necessarily know. We kind of believe, but we don't know, but it's important. Now you've got fire coming out of that bedroom, and you decide you're going to flow water from the outside. What's the best way to flow that water? In our case, we would take a straight stream off the ceiling so we could rain water down on all of the contents in that room, doing the least amount of air entrainment into that room, allowing that steam to come back out through the window. Now, if you open up a fog nozzle in that window and start whipping it around, are you going to push steam and heat onto that victim? Probably not really, because it's a high pressure back here. There's no flow path. There's nowhere for that to go to. It wants to come here. Are you going to create mixing? Sure. Which could help you suppress the fire, which will cool, which will contract the gases and possibly help that person. What about now? Are you going to open up a fog line on that window? Probably not a good idea with what you're going to push, what can move this direction. Now, are you going to force the fire out of this room and into that room? You're not going to push the fire through. You're not going to make the fire jump from room to room by putting water on the fire. Now, can heat and steam move that direction? Sure. It could be wet and miserable. But if you put water in this window, you are not going to push the fire into the other room. Here's an example done recently by NIST, our friends that do testing with us. They're a federal government agency. I worked there for 8 years before I moved to UL. This is an acquired structure they had in South Carolina, where you've got a room on fire here, room on fire here, a stairwell in the middle, and they're trying to get fire throughout the entire second floor. This is a thermal imaging view of this stairwell. What they're trying to demonstrate here is, one, how much air you can move with a nozzle, and two, if you use your stream the proper way, you will not force combustion products into the structure. You'll actually cool the gases and put the fire out. So water's going to go in through this window right here using a straight stream. Now, in our case, they're probably flowing maybe 500 liters a minute. See here? Nothing's coming down, nothing's pushing. It's all on fire, but this room gets put out. No pushing. Now, the walls are all combustible. That's what you see, the flames there. There's paneling on the walls. Now, over here, what we're going to do is we're going to take a wide fog pattern and not put a lot of water in the window, but entrain a lot of air. And then watch this here. Their goal was to not put water in the window to start, but then begin to put water in. Watch here. Now, would we have pushed fire into the first floor? No. But did heat and steam come down the stairs? Absolutely. But once water starts going in the window, it starts to suppress that room fire and doesn't push it down the stairs. So again, what's water? What's air? Your pattern matters. How you shape it, how you move it is all important. And then I'll wrap up with a scenario like this. You arrive, you have fire coming out of the third floor of a wood frame building. We have these all over the place. How long would it take to stretch a hose line into the building, up the stairwell to the third floor? Take minutes. We have these things on top of our fire trucks that we call deck guns. Or water monitors. What if he can make that problem go away in 30 seconds instead of waiting for 3 minutes and 30 seconds for water to come in from the other side? Are we going to push fire throughout that structure? No, we're going to put the fire out or knock it down. Does that hose crew still need to go in there and finish the fire off? Absolutely they do. Do they need to search? Absolutely they do. What if that happened while they were getting the line up there, they forced the door open, and instead of being greeted with a ventilation limited fire, they're now greeted with a bunch of contents on fire and a wet, soggy mess. Why would you not do this? Do you guys do this?
We don't have monitors.
Don't have monitors. Why not?
We don't have enough water.
Because you don't have enough water. All right, well, what if you had a... Instead of pulling the high-pressure reel, you have a quickly deployable low pressure where you can flow, let's say, 400 liters a minute.
That's just the problem. We just have a first response with a high pressure only.
Sure.
So that's 9 times out of 10 that's being pulled off the rig and being used. So, and it's only limited to 150 liters a minute.
Sure.
Sure.
So if you pull up and you have, what's how many liters of water do you have on your first engine?
Between 1,800 and 2,000.
1,800 and 2,000. So that's what, 400, 500 gallons? If you flow 100 gallons a minute for 10 seconds, you got plenty of water left to do your interior attack line. A lot of people think if I open a a high flow, low pressure line, then I'm going to run out of water really fast. Well, when you only need 10 seconds of it, you don't use a lot of water. Now, if you sit there all day and continue to flow that, even though you made the fire go down, and you continue to sit there and flow the water where it's really not doing much other than flooding at that point, then yeah, you're going to run out of water real quick, and you're going to have a crew inside with no water on their attack line. That's bad. But when you train on it and it becomes a tool in the toolbox, or you add that capability to your engine, that might be something that might make a lot of sense. Do you pull up to many fires where you've got fire coming out of the third, fourth, or fifth floor of an apartment building? It happens, right? You guys don't have a lot of sprinklers. I know it happens. So, do you take 5 minutes to get to it, or do you do something about it pretty quickly and then follow it up with that line stretch? Something to think about. I'm not telling you how to do things. So I could only scratch the surface. We've got 6 online training programs that highlight a lot of what I talked about, and they're all free. They are in English, so that might be an issue, but we're working on doing some translating. Here's our website. There's a lot more stuff here. This is our friend's website, nist.gov/fire. They've got a lot of great research as well. We've got the International Society of Fire Service Instructors that has a lot of good stuff. There's a free, if you're into fire investigation, they've got a lot of good free courses on fire dynamics and things like that, cfitrainer.net. The IAFF has a great YouTube channel that has a lot of free training. The Los Angeles County Fire Department has a lot of professionally done training videos that you could learn something from. Now, are they going to be in the American context? Absolutely. But is there stuff that you can take away from them to put into your context that could be of value? Maybe. But it's out there and it's free. FSTAR is a program through the International Association of Fire Chiefs where they show chiefs possible ways to implement science into their operations. And then we have a partner website, modernfirebehavior.com, where we take all of the discussion on the internet about science and firefighting, and we put them together in one place, so there's a lot of commentary about what seems to be working, what doesn't work, and what people are scared about, what people aren't scared about, and a lot of opinions. You'll see some stuff from Stefan. You'll see stuff from possibly several people in this room on that website. My contact information, I'm going to put some cards out in the front, or I can go grab some out of my bag, but feel free to send me emails. Search for UL Firefighter Safety Research on Facebook, Twitter, UL_FSRI. That's our handle. Use that. And then, of course, on YouTube, we have hundreds of hours of fire videos on our YouTube channel. So, again, another free resource. None of it costs a dime. All of it's stuff that you can go learn from. Questions? Concerns? Tired? Lunch was good? No questions? Please. Why not? I think that'd be a pretty good idea. Well, you've got a balance, right? So again, it depends. So you've got a fire in a room. You can see the fire behind the window, but the window hasn't failed yet. You know that you have 10 meters, 100 meters, 200 meters to get to that fire from the other side. So if you go around the structure, see that that's your problem, or that what you believe is the start of your problem, you now have a choice to make. I can put myself in the flow path. I can control the door, but I'm going to go in the flow path, and I might have 5 minutes before I get to the fire. Or I can break this window, give more oxygen to the fire, but I can also use my water to put the fire, knock the fire down. You could do both, depending on your resources. It takes one person on a hose line with a tool to break a window and put water on it. And then as that fire is smaller, you could stay there to make sure it doesn't keep getting bigger, because it might take the crew 5-10 minutes to get there on the other side. They might not even make it, depending on what the layout is. So again, I would highly consider that as a good option. Yeah. Not yet. We have a project coming up where we're going to look more at water, where we're going to study where the water goes. This is another thing that's kind of a pet peeve of mine, and maybe it's more of an American thing, but you pull up and you've got water, or you got fire coming out of a window, or fire coming out of a door. Our usual response is, I'm going to shoot water right through the center of that door. Well, if you really look at it and you took the fire away and you looked at where the water went, where's the water actually going? Exactly. It's going through the fire, making a hole about that big, and wetting the back wall and flooding the floor. What if you went to that same opening and put it off the ceiling? You'd probably have a different impact. Same thing goes with stream shapes. There's a whole lot of debates about straight stream, fog nozzle, things like that. Well, where's the water actually going? What's it actually doing? We don't really know. We don't really pay that much attention to it. See fire flow water. I have an opinion that we can be more surgeons. Our other problem is, if this room were on fire and we put it all out and there's a glowing ember in the corner that's left over from like a piece of a sofa, I'm going to flow 180 gallons a minute onto that ember until there's no more ember. We don't dial our nozzles. We don't, in many cases, use... We aren't very efficient. We err on the side of safety. We say that, well, our firefighter safety is most important, so we're going to flow as much as we possibly can because that'll maximize safety. And I think we need to get back towards... Is firefighter safety important? Absolutely right it is. However, there's a difference between the theoretical, absolutely efficient amount of water and the maximum amount of water. The answer is in the middle. The question is, can we operate in the middle and move back and forth as needed? Now, if Hans pulls up on a fire that's an industrial fire that has fire coming out of 10 windows and he can flow 100 liters a minute out of a high-pressure handrail, what good is he going to do? How quickly can you scale up? Our problem is we're not really good at scaling down. So there's a happy medium there somewhere, right? So it's, do you pull off flowing 4,000 liters a minute every time? No. But is there going to be the fire where you're going to need 4,000 liters a minute? Absolutely. So... we need to be smart. We need to know more. We need to be more like surgeons and less like sledgehammers. Please. Oh, I can't wait for this one. What do you got?
Well, you gave us a lot of examples where you actually made a few points. Like, there is plenty of people and there is plenty of water.
Sure. Sometimes yes, sometimes no. Are there places in the United States that don't have a lot of water? Much of the United States does not have a lot of water. I worked in an area right outside of Washington, D.C., where we had a 2-meter water line running down the middle of a highway. We could get tens of thousands of gallons a minute out of our water system that was very well spread out, no problem. You go a couple hundred kilometers away from there, they have a couple ponds in town, and they have water tankers that have, say, 8,000 liters, whatever it is, that's all they have. Or they have engines that have 2,000 liters of water, and that's all they're going to have for 10 minutes. So do they operate very differently than the guys with all the water? Sure. Are they using things like CAFs? Sure they are. Do we try and say that there's one answer and apply that CAFs is the answer to all of our fire problems, therefore ye shall all have CAFs? We tend to want to do that, and we tend to force that opinion on people, and people become very defensive, and immediately they reject the technology because people are swearing it's the answer. And I went to one fire, and I opened the line, and too much air came out, and I got burned. That's the CAF's fault, so we're going to throw the CAFs off the fire engine and never use it again. Same thing happened with positive pressure fans. You pull up with a positive pressure fan, you use it on a fire, burns the house down. Clearly the fan's fault. So we're going to put the fan in the basement, and we're going to say PPV is the worst thing in the world. We're going to get on the internet, and we're going to call every single person that uses positive pressure attack all kinds of names because it didn't work one time, and even if you did use it right, that was one time. You get one data point, and you now cast a net over every possible scenario known to man. That's a problem. But we tend to, we look for the silver bullet. We look for the one answer. Stefan, please tell me how to train. There's got to be one way.
No, it depends.
It depends. Until we can be thinking firefighters and we understand what it depends on, and we know when to use some tools and when not to use other tools, we're just a bunch of monkeys, just a bunch of robots. And we can't train our people like robots because we, in the past, have tended to do that. Left foot first, right foot next, right hand on nozzle, crack nozzle, close nozzle, spray door, close, move three steps, spray, move three steps, spray. What fire is that good for? Probably really good for some. Probably absolutely useless for others. But if we only have one game plan, you might as well just stand out in the street and flow water and put on a pretty show. Because we need our... Firefighting is complicated. It's complex. It requires very intelligent people to do this job. And for some reason, we tend to try and say that it's not complicated and anyone can do it and all you need is big muscles and a lot of water and stuff like that. It's not the case. We can pretend that we want to be macho and make a macho profession out of it and a lot of things like that. But my opinion is some of the smartest people I know are firefighters. And they're not PhDs. And they didn't go to school for 40 years. But when they take the time to know fire behavior and get experience and put the two together, they can probably tell you more about what's real than a lot of people can tell you. And they're the ones to say, it depends. But they have substance behind that because they know what it depends on. Those are your good firefighters, not the ones that, well, why do we do that, Captain? Well, that's the way we've always done it. That's a cop-out. I mean, that's a person that doesn't understand their profession, and they know that if they say that, it'll shut up the young person that's trying to learn and make the problem go away. Not good. Please.
Steve, I'm going to think back to the very beginning. You started by saying, you know, fires today are hotter, they burn faster. What's the fire community trying to do to turn the tide there? I mean, to me, you've got to almost go back to the root.
It's a great question.
If you can start reducing the combustibility of the materials in the homes, you're going to give the firefighters more time to act, or you may even have less fires.
Absolutely. UL is doing unbelievable amounts of things in the prevention space. One of the things that we're heavily working on is upholstered furniture. We work with the mattress industry as well as many other groups did. We can't claim sole responsibility for this, but several years ago we were starting to see really large fires when mattresses caught fire, and the mattress industry acknowledged that and said we want to do something about it. So they created or implemented a barrier technology where if you wrap the combustible foam in certain types of barriers, that it can limit the size of the fire. 200 kilowatts as a threshold. So if you have a 200 kilowatt mattress fire and that's the only fire you have burning in that room, you're not going to flash that room over. Well, the same doesn't exist for upholstered furniture. Now, some would argue that upholstered furniture is a little more complex, that it's not as simple as a mattress. But there's a technology that the mattress folks have proven has worked, and it doesn't involve pumping foam full of fire retardants. It doesn't involve making it not comfortable. It doesn't involve driving the price through the roof. They've been able to optimize the use of barriers to keep price points low, and it's become law in the United States, and any mattress after 2008 has this barrier on it. And if you come to UL, every day you're going to see mattress after mattress after mattress after mattress being tested that have ungodly amounts of foam in them and are really comfortable, not burning like that, staying below 200 kilowatts. So we're working to get upholstered furniture there too, because we believe that furniture can be cost effective, it can be comfortable, and it can be safe. You can accomplish those things with the modern technology we have. We're really pushing sprinkler technologies. We support the sprinkler industry quite a bit. Keep the fire small. Make it so you don't need 500 gallons a minute to fight a fire. In my opinion, if you pull up and you have fire coming out of a window, there's been many failures that have occurred already. How do we keep fire from coming out of the window? And a lot of it is limiting those large fuel sources. I mean, if you have a fuel load in a house that can't produce more than 200 kilowatts in a room, you're not going to have fire coming out of windows. You're not going to have ventilation limited fires all over the place like we do now. Sure. Sure. Well, the one solution that they've used is they've heavily fire retarded their foam. Now we're starting to hear of a lot of situations where we have experts in human health and air quality where some of those and many of those fire retardants have the potential of being carcinogenic. They can cause cancer. So how does it get out of the foam? How long does it take to get out of the foam? Is it in the air that you're breathing in your house every day when you sit on the sofa? I think there's a lot of things that need to be answered there.
A lot of flame retardants don't do that.
Absolutely. So it's getting that balance, right? And if, I guess the big question is, can we look at the UK statistics and say that they have less fire coming out of windows because they've taken a big hit at the upholstered furniture problem? The statistics might be there to prove that. I don't know personally, but have dropped dramatically.
I don't know about fire out the windows.
Sure. Well, that's... I'm a fire guy. I think about it that way. Yes? 5 minutes? Oh, wow. We still have time. I thought I was way over. Other questions? Is it possible to kind of watch some U.S.-based videos and learn something, or was a lot of that like, oh, God, what are they doing, or that doesn't apply to me, or... Do you see similar problems? Do you have firefighters that don't know as much about fire dynamics as you would like them to? Yeah? It's good. So we've got a lot of work to do. And I think we do it together. None of us are in this alone. So it'll be... I know I'm excited personally because of the stuff that IFV is doing, some of their own experiments, which if you don't know about those, you should begin to ask questions and learn about them, because the stuff they're doing is phenomenal. We're doing some positive pressure tests in January, and I'm excited that Renee is going to allow some of his staff to come and watch those tests, because it's my understanding that you have questions too about the use of positive pressure fans. So why would you replicate what I'm going to do, and I'm not going to replicate what you're going to do, but we got to learn from each other, and he's going to figure out what holes exist in what I'm doing and what doesn't apply. This is like, it's like I timed this. There's Ricardo in the back of all right, well, what doesn't make sense in our context? And instead of running 50 experiments, maybe we only need to run 5 and then build on the stuff that UL did. And we all get better. So I think there's some momentum in that area. And I look forward to definitely working with anyone that wants to be a part of this. Other questions? Thank you for taking the time.